Hello Pokemon fans the world over, welcome back to the 2016 Pokemon Trading Card Game European International Championships. I'm Nick Pierce and I'm here with David Hockman, and we have got the last stream game for you here today.
Yeah, it will be a very interesting matchup. We have two insanely well-known players. We have Mace Brenningmeyer, who finished second at the World Championship once, and his opponent, Michael Premerwald, he also was second at the US Nationals a few years ago. And just in general, very incredible players. They've both been playing for a long time, so they're very experienced, and I'm really looking forward to see how this matchup goes. Here we have Mace Brenningmeyer. He's playing the Greninja deck. He's also very familiar with it. He played it, I think, at all the regionals here in Europe. So I think this will be a very interesting game to see. His opponent from the United States, Michael Premerwald, yes. He's playing Evil Togarvador.
Yes, and of course, another important thing to mention, as rostered just before we went to our break, Michael is also familiar with being second as a world champion in 2010. So really, a face-off of a world runners-up is really going on here.
Oh yeah, that's true. I didn't really have this in mind. I mean, of course, he was second at Worlds, he was also second at US Nationals. When you come to this tournament, there are people who have so many accomplishments that you just can't remember all of them at once. So I'm really looking forward to this game. I just hope it's not going to be one player not drawing the as well as they want to. As we just see them flipping their cards and Mace going first, which actually is very good in this matchup.
Yeah, definitely. He's going to be able to, and you see he got a dive hold there as well, so he's going to be able to get himself another Froakie here, which is exactly what he wants to see. We don't want to see a repeat of, as exciting as it is, we don't want to see a repeat of what Frank Diaz did at the end of yesterday, you know, just Max Elixir, just KO alone star you for the win.
Yeah, this is true. So Mace is going to get a second Froakie. I'm also pretty sure he has an energy and Frogadier in his hand, so when you have this, you usually don't play another supporter card. All you really need for your first turn is just have two Froakies, and then for the turn afterwards, all you need is just Frogadier and energies. And then you need a lot of cards, but for the first few turns, just having Froakie is fine. Here we see at the beginning of his hand, just Frogadier energy, and here we see him just ending his turn, going over to Michael Premerwald.
Yeah, we have a look at the prize cards right now. We see, again, the prizes, as is most often the case, not too bad for either player. Like, two ends and two versus seekers prize for Mace isn't the best, but at the same time, nothing that's unworkable, really.
Yeah, so Mike just attaching an energy active. His hand is Versus Seeker. Lysander, not really looking like he has another way to draw any cards. So he just ends his turn. So now Mace's turn, he can just evolve, attach an energy card. And then it will be interesting to see if he does anything but that, or if he just goes straight into water duplicates.
Yeah, a bit of an unfortunate turn for Pram there. Literally just say attach energy and pass. Although, if there's any deck that you want to do that against, not that you ever want to do it, but if there's any deck where you're more okay with doing that, it is against Greninja, because you know you're going to have a few turns of you know, them setting up with their water duplicates to be able to draw cards from the top of your deck and hopefully see something to draw you out of it.
Yeah, we already saw that, but now Mace showed us officially that there is no Frogadier in his prize cards. And like my colleague already said, Michael just needs another energy to draw one prize card. So I think that's okay. I'm also pretty sure he just got the Professor Sycamore from top of his deck. So Michael is thinking about which direction does he turn his Perilous City. Of course, if he puts the blue side on his opponent, Mace can just discard a Froakie, which is not that bad, but he decides to go for the red side, which means Mace only deals 20 damage less for all of his attacks. And here we see Michael's previous hand, just Escape Rope and Handshammer. And Handshammer is actually pretty nice in this match, because Mace is playing four of the Splash Energy cards. But it's not that hard to discard. And now Michael just needs any energy card to finish off with either Evil Ball or Wise Cyclone. If he gets another bench Pokemon, that would be great, but there isn't a risk for Mace winning the game next turn.
Yeah, it's funny how, you know, obviously at the beginning, when Greninja first came out, starting to really gain in popularity, Splash Energy really didn't see any play at all, despite, I believe it came out in the same set, didn't it? It came out in Breakpoint as well, so, but even then they just played Basic Waters, because you think, oh, you know, with Splash Energy, I can't use Giant Water Stroke, and why would I want to play that? But now, after the rotation happened, and going further into this current standard format, we see, you know, list going from maybe playing one Splash Energy to zero to three to four, and it seems every single Greninja list we've seen today has played three to four Splash Energy, I'm
fairly
sure.
Yeah, the reasoning of not playing that many Splash Energies, like I already said, is just that you then can play more Water Energy cards. But Water Energies, of course, when you don't have your Water Energies, you can't use abilities. But in this metagame, where you have so many Garbodor decks, which prevent you from using abilities anyways, the Splash Energies get more valuable, because you need to actively attack more. Greninja used to be a deck where you just set up and then at the end of the game you just show your opponent all your energy cards and then you use a giant water shrieking to win the game. But in this format you have to be just like a very, very normal deck where you just try to attack every turn, retreat, because you have a lot of HP, you don't get knocked out that fast. That was very different last year, but it's interesting to see how these kind of deck evolves. And four splash energies in this meta game with so much Evil Torgalador is a very smart play, I think.
Yeah, it is good, but it does bring, like with anything, there's always a trade-off with these sorts of decisions. You do have the extra versatility of being able to put the lines back in your hand and re-evolve everything, and it allows you to, as you said very rightly, go to that slightly different game plan. But the one thing that it does mean is that, especially now that everyone's playing Enhanced Hammer, originally Enhanced Hammer was a card that the Greninja deck wasn't never really afraid of, and now it has to be, because obviously Splash Energy being a special energy, it can be discarded with Enhanced Hammer, and so many lists are packing, you know, two copies of Enhanced Hammer now.
Yeah, another argument of not playing that many Splash Energies is that with Moonlight Slash, you usually just take the energy back because you need to deal more damage anyways. However, yeah, now you have more situations where you can just use Moonlight Slash. Mace also played down his Rust Seas. It's another great card in the Yveltal matchup, because if Yveltal is not able to take one knockout with only one hit, then the Greninja has no retreat cost, so you can just put it on your bench, put another Greninja active, and then use Rust Seas until there's no damage on the Greninja anymore to kind of prevent your opponent from taking two hit knockouts.
Yeah, and we see their Prime Reinforce of Sycamore again. Yeah, exactly, that's what I was thinking as well. Very ugly Sycamore, and, well, I mean, Franco has finally seen another basic off. This has seen a Trubbish that's going to put him in very good stead. He's going to want to get that evolving into a Garbodor as quickly as possible, because as it stands right now, Mace is guaranteed at least one turn of actually being able to Giant Water Shuriken, which is really not what Michael wants to see right now.
Yeah, Trubbish is important to have in your second turn as the Evil Top player, but Michael didn't draw anything after he's played as Professor Sycamore, so unfortunately, Mace will be able to use a Giant Water at least. In theory, he's able to use at least one Giant Water Shuriken, maybe a second one, but for this he needs Greninja Break and Water Energies. But let's see what his hand is looking like. Michael here, very smart, just going for the Y-Cyclone, securing his energy cards, because he knows Mace might be able to just heal 120 on the active Pokémon with abilities. If that happens, he doesn't want to have all the energies, but now Mace might even just, when he has options for two Giant Water Shrieking, just might want to take out the Trubbish so he can continue using Giant Water Shrieking later in the game.
Yeah, well, the debate that Mace is having mentally right now is, and I think he's probably settled on that, is, yeah, because you could make a decision to evolve the bench Greninja instead and have a Greninja Break with, you know, the full HP rather than, you know, only having 70 damage on it already, but I think he's just deciding that he would rather have the option of maybe being able to Water Shuriken, and then if he can see another Greninja Break, retreat into that Greninja Break and Water Shuriken again.
Yeah, and Mace is going for the knockout on the Trubbish, but this is not the only thing. Having damage on Trubbish in general is pretty good, because then he can Lysander it later on, and then take the knockout with Moonlight Slash, and he can even take the knockout with Moonlight Slash without returning the energy card, so Splash Energy is taking full advantage here. But if Mace happens to draw into another Greninja Break and another Water Energy card to knock out the Trubbish, I'm sure he is happy to take this.
Yeah, definitely. One strategy that's that the Greninja decks had to deal with Garbodor previously, if it was played, is to just attach a Muscle Band and then, you know, do Moonlight Slash for 100 that way to knock out straight away. But given that Muscle Band is no longer in rotation and standard, you can't really do that. So the only way is, as you said, do 20 damage to it, or at least that with something else, and then follow up with a Moonlight Slash for the knockout, which is why some of this we've seen him play the promo Greninja.
Yeah, but now Mace has an Ultra Ball in his hand and one Water Energy card. And you might think, why is he thinking now? He can just take out the Break, then take out the knockout on the Trubbish. But the struggle is that he then doesn't have another energy to just attack with. He also has no energies in his prize cards, we can see this, so there is no way he is able to attack this turn. So he has to think, does he rather want to attack or use the ability this turn? And Mace should know that there is no energy cards in his prize now, if he really is thinking about it, but he just wants to take out the Trubbish. Because the Rust Seas is in play, the active Greninja can take a hit, especially when you have the 170 HP from the Greninja Break. And here we see Mace just taking out the Trubbish, giving him another turn of abilities next turn. Because he only plays 6 of the Water Energies, it's not that likely that he gets 2 Giant Water Shrieking again next turn, but if he does, I think he can see this game already.
Yeah, he's already in a very commanding position. As we mentioned in previous games with Greninja, it's not very often that Greninja takes a lead like this, but when it does, it can be so devastating, because it's already a deck that normally falls behind, so if your opponent is slow enough to the point where you're setting up and you're actually in the lead. I mean, sure, it means you don't have access to stuff like Ace Trainer, which the Greninja list normally plays, but it still means you're in a very, very good position.
Yeah, it's a big difference from the like retro Greninja, where Ace Trainer and Sycamore were the only supporters you had, because now you have N, so Ace Trainer isn't that important anymore. In most Greninja decks right now, it's just like a cool one-off that you have.
Yeah.
But yeah, Mace is able to take an early lead, and Michael also, he needs another Trubbish. And how many does he play? I'm pretty sure there are only two in his deck. Yes.
Indeed, there are.
So not like, for example, Philip, which we saw earlier on stream, or Ross Corson, they both play three Trubbish. But Michael only plays two, so he has to draw the one, the last one. If that one gets knocked out, then he's in big trouble.
Yeah, and yeah, it's a little bit of a spot of bother for him. So right now, it looks like he's just deciding what really to do. It's hard to know what. Okay, so he's got double colored energy. You can put that on the active, and he has the option again of doing either Evil Ball or Y Cyclone. Y Cyclone would mean he could, you know, put an extra double colors onto that Yveltal, which already has a lot of energy on it, and it looks like that's what he's going to opt to do. And the more he does this, the more he's able to build up an Yveltal EX to the point where he can actually do a one hit knockout on a Greninja break, which could come into play later on, and it's important to be prepared for this.
This is true, but now Michael didn't have a Trubbish, so Mace's priorities shift. Now he doesn't need to take out a Trubbish, he can just put damage on the Yveltal, which is a threat, and right now it's the one on the bench with the energy cards. So yeah, it will be very problematic for Michael to come back here, but of course, everyone knows the card N, and especially when Greninja attacks and takes the energy back to their hand, they're really depending on drawing another energy card. So Michael doesn't concede here, because he knows, well, there is still a good chance that he can just win later game when he has one Yveltal that takes one it knocks out for days, and then he can just play. And when Mace doesn't get an energy, Michael can just win in a few turns.
Yeah, so you see there, Mace has got a decision of where to attach his Bursting Balloon. Yeah, he probably realizes that he wants to, even if he doesn't end up doing the double Water Shuriken, he can just retreat into the other Greninja, so attaching to the benched Greninja break does make sense.
Yeah, and greatly enough, he gets one Splash Energy and one Water Energy, so at least one Water Shuriken. He also has a Frogadier, so everything is running great for Mace here.
Yeah, it really is, and what he could do is he's got another Greninja break, like I just said. That's all of them. That's all the Greninja breaks he plays.
Yeah, so he has to trade off if he wants to attack with the one with the Bursting Balloon, which is always a great option. But that one has some damage on it, so if he takes a knockout on the active Yveltal, which if he wants to, he needs to return the energy, otherwise it's not enough damage. Then yeah, he might get knocked out by the benched Yveltal. Otherwise, it's very hard to retreat the active one and get the one-hit knockout. Now Mace use the retreat. Now he can use the Giant Water Shuriken if he wants to. And if not, just attack. I'm actually not very sure if it's the right play to use the Giant Water Shuriken right now, as Mace also thinks this way. For Michael to take a knockout here, he would need to hit a lot of Max Elixirs, I think. Right now there are 5 energies attached to Yveltal, so that's 120 damage. But, that's not enough for the one-hit knockout, and he cannot attach a Floatstone active. If he plays something like Escape Rope, Mace can just put the Greninja with the Bursting Balloon active. This is the reason why he did this. But Michael says he doesn't want to play this game. He plays Pokemon Central Lady, a card that is great in the Mirror match. I think this is the main reason why people have it in their deck. But of course, in these kind of situations, it can also shine.
Yeah, it's a really great play from Michael, because what that means is that Yveltal EX in the active is no longer in range of just a Giant Water Shuriken KO in the middle of Mace's turn. One of the real strengths of Giant Water Shuriken is because you have this ability that can just put 6 damage counters on something and take a knockout like that in the middle of your turn. It's one of the few situations where you can take cards out of your prizes and use them in the same turn you take them, and it gives you like so many more options to work with. But because Michael did the Pokemon Center Lady, Mace is no longer afforded the option to do that.
Yeah, what I also like to mention is Mace's prize cards are 2 N, 2 Versus Seek, and 1 Ace Trainer. So whichever prize card he takes, it's always just like a supporter card. It's very interesting, because prize cards are often very important, and if Mace realizes that all of his prize cards are supporter cards, he can also play just in a completely different way. He can be more aggressive. So for example, when you only have a Versus Seeker in your hand and you don't really want to use that for stuff like Lysander, but when you know in your prize cards there are draw supporters anyways, you can be a bit more risky.
Yeah, definitely. You see the Mei's going for the first giant water stroke, and he's going to play a fisherman, so of course it's pretty good. So he's going to be able to get some those two water energies that he has in his discard back. He's going to be able to do another giant water stroke, and I'm fairly almost certain that this Evelta-EX in the active is going to hit the discard pile.
Well, he can also just put 120 on the one with a lot of damage, because then if Michael wants to attack with the bench one, again, he needs to retreat the active one, then loses all of his energy cards. And then when he attacks with his Evertal, it will get knocked out, so that would put Mace in the situation where he can just discard all energies in field. And now Mace has a splash energy, again he has to consider, do I return it or do I return it not? Neither of them gives him the knockout, but if he does not return it, there's one energy more that you just have attached to it. This means more evil ball damage, so I think it was very good for him to return the energy card, leaving Michael's Evertal that has the Fighting Fury belt attached to it with 180 damage. And now Michael has to really consider his options. How about the switching options in Michael's deck? I'm actually not entirely sure what kind of cards he uses.
He plays one Escape Rope, and that's pretty much it. There's no Olympia, there's no switches, nothing else like that. I think one Escape Rope is pretty much his only switching option, apart from Floatstone.
But he cannot retreat it. Yeah, so Mike is in a kind of problematic situation. What do you even do here? Just dealing some chip damage on the active one doesn't really help because of Rust Seas, and you have so much retreat, and then you can just retreat around. You have retreat, and you have so much HP that you can just retreat around and then always use Rust Seas. So Michael would really need something like just a counter stadium here, but it doesn't really look great for him.
It's such a clever play from Mace, because exactly as you said, he didn't actually, as much as I said, Vialta's going to hit the discard pile this turn, he didn't really need to. He's not in a rush to take these prizes, and he can just swarm Michael's field with damage and then just have that one turn where he just goes bang, 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 bang with water shurikens and just wins there. He doesn't need to take all his prizes until he has that game-winning turn.
Yeah, going back to Michael's turn, he decided to just go for a Lysander. Like I already said, it doesn't really make sense to just do a little damage to Greninja Break with his board position. And also, he just needs to draw a lot of prize cards in general. We also see his second rubbish is prized, actually. So I think earlier I said he needs to draw it. When it's in the prize cards, of course, there is no possibility to do this. So Mace, of course, Mace doesn't know, but Mike is in a big trouble here. If he actually wants to win this game, he needs to hope for a shorter second game, or he needs to concede this one. Because Mace does not have stuff like Octillery or Talonflame, like I already mentioned, N hurts him a bit more than other Greninja decks. But if Mace has three energy cards, he can even take like four prize cards this turn. And then it will be hard for Michael to return no matter what, because he loses so many energy cards.
Yeah, it's really, and also we see that the Rough Sea is already putting in so much work. We saw that, the Evelta-EX did, say, 100 damage to each of those Greninja Breaks with Y-Cyclone, but already the Rough Sea is just healing 30 a turn, has put them both, he's healed off one Greninja Break entirely, and it's put the other two down to 10 damage on them each. It's just it's as if the Evelta's attacks did nothing.
Yeah, this is true, and this is, I think, one of the main reasons why people decide to play Rough Seas instead of, which was very popular, Faded Town, which deals more damage against Mega Pokemon. But now I think when you saw the meta breakdown that Mega Pokemon are less popular than they used to be, you will face more Evelta Garbodor than, let's say, Mewtwo Garbodor. So Rust Seas is a good inclusion here. Mace is just checking everything. I think he's calculating how much damage Pram can deal with his Evelta and if it's worth going a bit more aggressive. But I don't think he has like a draw supporter in a sense, so only one giant water shuriken. However, he still decides to go for it, and let's see what he's choosing to do now.
Yeah, it's a bit unfortunate that he can't take the knockout on that bench Evelta. Of course, if he had two water energies, he could do double giant water shuriken and take out that Evelta deck, which would put him in a commanding position at this point.
Yeah, and now I think this is great here. He has the energy attached to his active Evelta, and in this situation, it would be usually just in general better to keep the line, because then when you get knocked out, you can take the Greninja back. But he has no draw supporter in his hand, which means if this Greninja get knocked out, he might just end up in the situation where he doesn't have any energy cards left. And yeah, like I already said, this doesn't really make sense. But and Mace probably doesn't know that all of his supporters, all of his prize cards are just supporter or versus eco cards. So not being entirely sure that this is the case, he decides to just take the energy back, just to have an energy next turn. And now Michael, when he plays N, he can win this game, actually. It doesn't really look that great, But N can turn around these gains so much, especially when Mies doesn't find another energy to attack with. But if he does, like, yeah, now he didn't even play N, so this option is out of the discussion here. So it doesn't really look great.
Yeah, that's a bit of an unfortunate turn for Michael. Had he had the end that turn, then, and if Mace missed the energy, then yeah, it actually Michael would be in a great set to win. As it stands, he knows that this Sivaltli X is being knocked out. So at this point, I'm not even sure if there's that much Michael can do to recover. He's going to lose so much once this Sivaltli gets knocked out.
Yeah, and now one additional thing. It's not even a great move, but I just want to talk about it, that he discarded the attached the energy to the bench Greninja, because usually it doesn't really matter. But when you attach it on the active, you do not have the option to double Giant Water Shuriken and attack in the same turn. So now Mace, by attaching the energy on the bench Pokemon, it didn't make any difference. But if he draws two energies now, he will win the game immediately because he can just knock out the Shaman. And let's see, it's very unlikely if that happens.
Also,
it doesn't. But because he drew the energy, he might even just be able to knock out the active one with Giant Water Shuriken and then just attack. And do not take the energy back to your hand, and then N is even less valuable for Michael if he gets it.
Yeah, and it looks like that's the option he's going to go for. So the water energy being discarded, Giant Water Shuriken means that he's going to be able to take two more prize cards. And yeah, Mace just commanding this game. He's got a handful of... I mean, even if he gets N at this point, he's retrieved all of his supporters out of his prize cards. He's got, you know, two more Versus Seekers to hand to be able to draw into, to draw into a water energy. It's looking really bad for Michael. It's unfortunate for him. But Mace has just played this very, very well.
Yeah, and like I said, he does not return his energy. He does not want to take the risk of losing against N. And now Michael is kind of off options. I know he got the trouble from his prize cards, but since Mace played N, it's not in his hand anymore, so he would need to draw it. And even if he does, now at this point of the game, it would be very hard for him to recover in general.
Yeah, he's got this Max Lick, so even if he hits anything off it, which it looks like he does, but... putting it on a Fright Knight Vessel doesn't really do much. You'd be 60 to the active. It's just...
Yeah, but what I just saw with this Max Elixir is that Michael actually plays two Enhanced Hammer. I see it here on the list as well. Didn't really pay too much attention to it. But these Enhanced Hammers, if he draws the Enhanced Hammer now, of course, this might turn all around the game. And if he is not able to attack, then Michael can apply a lot of pressure. But also, since there is no Stadium in play, Mace can just retreat a bit around. If he has a double... If he only has a double colors energy card, Mace might just... Oh, here's the Enhanced Hammer, so... This might become something. I don't really think so, but of course...
The only problem is, I think, and we'll see what happens this turn, but I think Mace drew a Versus Seeker off of the N. In which case, it won't matter.
Yeah, then he can just take his Fisherman and win the game. So let's see, Mace does have the Versus Seeker, Fisherman, just Giant Water Shuriken on the Shaman, again, then retreat, Giant Water Shuriken on the Shaman. That's it, so it's 1-0-4 Mace Brenningmeier. It was a very explosive game, it went very fast, just from the perspective of it, it actually took a lot of time, but in general it was Mace dominating the whole time. But usually, this matchup is not that easy. Mace put a lot of effort in his list to have a better matchup against Yveltal Garbodor. But as you saw, Michael knows his win options, and he knows that N can just be so devastating in this matchup that he didn't concede to take more time, knowing that once he has won Yveltal with a lot of energy cards, he can just... Yeah, grab some easy one.
Yeah, Michael did not lose that game on the basis of making a mistake. He just lost because Mace was just able to better set up and do all this stuff. Michael knew that the avenues he had to take to win, and he did every single one. It just, unfortunately for him, wasn't enough in the end because Mace managed to draw out the end. So that's really all it came down to in the end.
The problem Michael had is that he didn't have Trubbish in a second turn, but in a third turn, and also that Mace got two energy cards. Otherwise, he could have got off his Garbodor, and once you have Garbodor in play, this matchup becomes... very, very different because your bench Pokemon don't get any damage anymore, so you can do stuff like Scary Turn loops and then retreat Pokemon on your bench that have a lot of damage, and then your opponent needs to play Lysander. That's the one Trubbish was surprised, and that he also didn't have the Trubbish in the game. I think this is what cost him the game, but of course he tried to do his best with the N at the end. Unfortunately, it didn't pay out.
Yeah, so, of course, Michael will be going first in Game 2. We're assuming he will. I don't see any reason why he wouldn't. And with that, he'll be afforded a few extra turns to be able to find that Trubbish, put the Floatstone on it, and evolve it into Garbodor, which, of course, would mean that Mace would not be able to do the same. Because he really... What the reason why Mace was able to take such a commanding lead is because, as you very rightly said, Michael was not able to find access to Trubbish, so therefore he couldn't get into Garbodor, so Mace was just free to just giant Water Shuriken everywhere, and at that point it was just too much for the Veltal Garbodor deck to handle.
Yeah, another Garbodor, another Trubbish prized, one Frogadier prized for Mace. We can see his prize cards already, I'm very sorry for spoiling this. So yeah, that might be a very similar take. Also, Michael is not starting with Yveltal EX, but rather with the Fright Knight Yveltal, which is not that good against this deck. Pitch Black Spear deals 60 damage to one of your opponent's bench Pokémon EX, which Mace does not have in this deck at all, so it's only 60 to the active Pokémon. With Rust Seas, it's basically, you don't do anything at all. And Michael's turn was just attaching energy and then ending his turn, so this is very sad to watch, to be honest.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's gotta be heartbreaking, especially considering, you know, this is the winning in, this is for Michael the winning in round, but you know, just your deck is not cooperating with you and you literally just get attached energy and pass. It's a heartbreaker any day of the week.
Yeah, but I'm also pretty sure Mason doesn't look that great. He discarded a Versus Seeker and a Bursting Balloon. Here you can also see the prize card, Jirachi being prized. He didn't use it last game, but it's actually a very good card in this matchup. You can just take the double colorless energy cards that your opponent really needs to take one at knockouts. And he has one of each, like he has one Frogadier, one Greninja, and one Greninja Break in his prize card. So the Frogadier being prized might actually become a problem, but since Michael only has his Fright Knight Yveltal, I don't think this is going to be an issue. And here we see Bubble.
Heads.
Actually, so even if Michael has a double colorless energy card, he can sneak like an easy knockout. Of course, he in theory he can, but
oh, see the
hand
hammer, which is pretty cool for him. And yeah, that actually the bubble making a big difference. But you see, he has drawn Professor Sycamore now.
Another one. And yeah, let's see. Now he got an Ultra Ball, so if he really wants to go for it, he can take a Trubbish. And now Mace again. His hand is not looking good. It's just one Versus Seeker Watch Energy and a Greninja. So another bubble. No, I mean, he would need, like, he has two turns, at least, as long as Michael doesn't have, like, escape rope floats and stuff going on. But let's see. The Yveltal Pitch Black Spear is not really good against Greninja, but it serves, it's good enough to knock out one Froakie.
Yeah, because it does exactly enough to see that 60 damage, so that will knock out a Froakie indeed. But yeah, Michael will be looking through now, and he's eyeing up that Trubbish. That's gone straight to the front of his deck. He knows that he was really missing that in the last game, and so
yeah, have you seen his face? He was just like, nah, again, one prize. Very annoying. I'm very sure that he checked this, but now that it's on the bench already, it's not that important that one of them is prized. And also, if Mace doesn't get a good card from top of his deck now, he will also be in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, the big difference between now and last game is that because he did find a Trubbish, but it was just at a point where Mace could just snipe it with a giant Water Shuriken. And this time instead, Michael's found it really nicely early before Mace can even really do much of anything, because there's it doesn't
like bubble again.
Yeah.
Bubble is such a great great attack. A lot of people underestimate it. But let's see if it's tails. Oh. Well, now Mace loses his energy card and also his Froakie. So in theory, Michael could win in two turns.
Yep.
And then there is actually enough time left for a full third game, so Michael can still take the whole set here.
Yeah.
And advance to top 8, so yeah, don't you think that it's over already?
It all really depends on Mace's next top deck at this point. If it's something usable, then yeah, maybe we'll actually see this game play out. If not, then we'll be going on to game 3.
Yeah, you know when you just play test, you can always just look at the top card of your deck?
Yeah.
And just concede. The tournament, of course, is unfortunately not possible. And here we see Michael playing Versus Seeker, not for N, unfortunately, for Mace, but Michael is not, well, he knows that Mace's hand is not that great anyways, and he also didn't have the N in the first place, but Mace, I think, would have been very happy about an N in this situation. Michael just going all in, yeah, he has, not really going all in, there's even a risk here. He got a lot of good cards here, just attaching more energies to his Yveltal EX, which he will need if Mace is able to set up, which it doesn't really look like he does.
Yeah, you can never make the assumption, if the win is really close, you can never make the assumption that it's actually going to happen, because as we've seen so many times, you know, things can turn around in a second, so you still do as much as you can to, you know, set up another attacker for later on. It's just the way to play well.
Well, you do as much as you can, as long as there is not a time issue. Of course, conceding is a very important factor of this game, because ties are not half a win, and yeah, Mace actually got a water energy, so he could have bubbled again. But he also needs to make sure that there is enough time left, because a tie doesn't help any of these players. So yeah, he could have tried to bubble again, but then he would needed either a supporter card or a way to get a Frogadier. Then he would have attacked with Frogadier and then put like two Frogadier on his bench because one was prized. So the bubble didn't really help. It would just have killed a lot of time for both of these players. So maybe it's just for the sake that they don't tie conceded here. And we're going to watch a game three.
Yeah, and I mean, again, as always, coming down to the wire, as you'd expect, given, you know, both these players obviously incredibly decorated, have been around for ages. I think we're looking at the deck list right now. Both of these players' player IDs are four digits long.
Yeah, I also noticed that. It's very cool.
It's basically, as more players come into the tournament system, the player numbers go higher and higher. Just to give you an idea, right now most new issued player IDs are somewhere like seven digits. So the fact that these are only four digits long really tells you how long both of these guys have been around.
Yeah, and also, like you already said, they both also have big success. Yeah, Michael with his Gardevoir deck, second at World Championship 2010, also big showings at the US Nationals, Mies also being in the finals of the Dutch Championships almost like every second year at least, and he also managed to be second at World Championships. So a very epic match going on here, and I really hope for both players that Game 3 is not going to look like Game 2 or Game 1.
Yeah, we want to see, you know, just a great, really close, tense match. Actually, you say not like Game 1. Game 1 was pretty close, all things considered.
It happened to be... Well, it was close on the assumption that Mace does not draw well with N. But then the only one option was just like, Mace doesn't draw well. But I want more mid options than Mace not drawing well or Michael not drawing well. I want win options like, oh, what do I do here? Do I charge the energy here? Do I play the Bursting Balloon here? Do I use Wild Cyclone? Do I use Evil Ball? I'm really looking forward to have this game of choices that this matchup might actually be able to show us.
Yeah, that would be
round.
Obviously the best. And we see there that's now the prices have gone out. And this is actually probably the best prizes for both players. I mean,
yeah, there's nothing important. You can't see them yet, but we'll come back to this. Mace is going first. He has a Professor Sycamore, so at least something. He also has a Frogadier, an energy card, and two Greninja. His only supporter is Professor Sycamore. So there's a big trouble because in theory, Michael just needs one energy and then a Max Elixir hit. Then either Escape Rope or a Floatstone to win the game. If Mace is not playing Professor Sycamore, if Mace plays Professor Sycamore, he discards one of his Frogadier, two of his Greninjas, and one versus Eco, one Professor Sycamore. The game did not freeze, if you look at Mace.
And he also discards a Super Rod if he does that as well. That's...
Oh, this is not good.
I think that's one of the ugliest Sycamore decisions you could ask for.
We had something similar, I think, in Italy when someone had also played Greninja and had the option between either discarding a lot of resources or having the risk of getting knocked out turn one. And he did, and he takes the risk. Okay. Michael is from the US, just like Frank Diaz. So they should know how to do this. Here we see a Max Elixir. We see two Max Elixir.
I'm not sure if my heart can take this again. Okay, I've seen this once. Like
another energy card? Okay. Now Michael just needs an energy card to win this game. If he's able, he either needs to draw it or hit the other Max Elixir. So we're getting really excited here. It's kind of sad because I really like Mace's play here. But, oh god, my heart is beating so fast right now. It's just like, we don't want to see that kind of stuff here. But
two games in a row! Like, I guess he's gonna hit it.
Oh my god, no! It's like, what is it with important matches where we feature Greninja? That is always just like one game where, okay, I went game one. It's amazing. I'm sorry if I screamed a lot. Yeah. Now they're discussing it. Mace asked his opponent, would you have played the Sycamore? And I'm really, this is the one question I want to ask Michael. Would you have played the Sycamore or would you have not played it?
Literally, David, last game yesterday, this happened. Last game today, this happened. Like, literally 2 days in a row is pretty much the exact same ending. Like,
yeah, this is true. This is true.
Well, dear.
Yeah, very unfortunate. I remember the old days where you could attack turn one, so Mace could have attacked with, like, bubble heads to prevent this. But, oh, come on. What is going on here? Greninja can do better. We all know this. But, yeah. Of course, just being able to do this turn one knockout with your max elixirs is also one thing that makes Evil Tile Garbodor even like better than stuff like Greninja, because when your opponent only has one Pokemon in play, let's see if Froakie. And you play Greninja, no matter how well you draw, you can't knock it out. But with deck like Evil Tile Garbodor, when you draw well, or just a very a bit above average is already enough to knock out the opponent's Pokemon the first turn, you can't do this. So like we saw yesterday with Frank and today with Michael, it's possible, and everything that is possible might happen at some point.
Yeah, it's a huge congratulations to Michael Pramor. That mean that victory does put him in contention for the top 8, I believe, with 31 match points.
Well, okay, now the problem is we have 9 people who might be in top 8, so there has to be one guy with his with his tiebreaker who is not into the top card. So, well, I'm actually, I don't know if I want Michael to be in the top card. Of course, I love seeing Evil Tile Garbodor mirror matches. I don't want to have too many Evil Tile Garbodors on stream. I don't like getting knocked out in your first turn without doing anything. But I really hope because Michael's a great player to see him in the top 8.
Yeah.